Hello, Dero. Today you are going to solve heat exchanger problems. So you'll have the first problem as stated here. So the problem statement is as, we have a concentric tube heat exchanger and we are using that heat exchanger for the gas turbine. The dimensions are given. So this one is the inner diameter of the heat exchanger and this one is the outer diameter. And then we have a mass flow rate of water and the mass flow rate of the oil. Okay, and then it says that find the required length of the heat exchanger if the oil lives at 60 degrees Celsius and the oil and the water inlet temperatures are 100 and 30 degrees Celsius respectively. So let's try the values. So T oil inlet is 100 degrees Celsius, T oil outlet is 60 degrees Celsius, and T water inlet is 30 degrees Celsius, and it says that find the length of the heat exchanger. Okay, so let's solve the problem. And this problem is, if you go back to our slides, and this one is size problem. Okay, and for the size problems we are using these equations. Okay, this one is used for the size problems, but if it is the temperature and the QTL problems, you can use these relations. Okay, if you go back to here, the first unknown here is that the water outlet temperature is not known. We can find it, and then we will use UALMTD. So you will use this relation, and this part we know we will find it after finding the temperature difference for both fluids, and F is 1, and then this area will give us the value of the length of the heat exchanger. Okay, so let's write the let's write our equations. And equation number one is that Q dot is M dot oil Cp oil into T oil outlet minus T oil inlet. Okay, let's use the positive values, therefore T oil inlet, which is higher, and outlet. And the second, the same equation will be M dot water and the Cp water, and then this one will be equal to water outlet temperature minus water inlet temperature, because we want all of the values to be positive. This one is positive, this one is positive, and the last equation will be Q dot will be equal to U A and into F into LMTD. Okay, and firstly we should find the Cp values. To find the Cp values, we need some average temperature. For oil it is okay, it will be that T inlet plus T outlet by 2, and inlet and outlet temperature of oil is okay, and the 160, and it will make the 80. And for water, we don't know any inlet, we don't know the outlet temperature. What we will do is that we will say that the water outlet temperature, we will assume some average temperature for water, and if it is 30 degrees Celsius, and let's say that the outlet is around 40, I don't know the value. This one is assumed. Okay, we will check at the end. Divide by 2 and 35. Okay, we are using this one, but at the end you will see that Cp of the water is not changing too much. Okay, it's not changing too much with temperature, therefore the values will be okay for us. Okay, now let's solve the problem, and we will solve the problem in Excel. So we know the m dot for oil we will find from this table, and we know this one, we know this one, we will find q dot here. And if you replace q dot back to here, you'll get the water outlet temperature, and then if you know the temperatures, we can find LMTD. F is 1 for the this one is a parallel fluid exchange, counter fluid exchanger, because one moves in that direction, the other one moves in opposite direction. This one is counter fluid exchanger, and F is 1 for counter fluid exchanger. And then you will need the area of the heat exchanger, and then this one will be found, and the U also will be okay because we can find it, and from here you will get the area, and from area we'll get the length of the heat exchanger. Okay, now let's solve it in Excel one by one. Okay, so if I move into Excel, so I'll write the values. Oil outlet inlet temperature will be 100. Oil outlet temperature will be 60. Water inlet temperature will be 30. And the water outlet temperature, I don't know it, but the what else do I know? The diameter inner is 25 E minus 3, diameter outer is 45 E minus 3, and m dot water is 0.2 and m dot oil is 0.1 kilograms per second, and average temperature for oil will be, let me write the average temperature for oil, it will be average of these two values, and the average temperature for water will be, so I will take 35 degrees, okay, this one is assumed, okay, let me say that, assumed, but we will check it for, when we finish the problem, we'll see that if it is good assumption or not. So we have the values here, so let's write the Q dot first for the oil, therefore I need the Cp value of oil, and then Cp value of water. So first the Cp of oil, if I go back the book, okay, this is the book that we used, and you will go to appendix. For the appendix, we need the appendix for the liquids. So if you go back the liquids, we have the liquids here. And for engine oil, for the temperature is 80 degrees Celsius, and the Cp value is this one. This one is the Cp value. Okay. And again, this one is for oil, sorry. For water, I will use temperature value here. Let's go back to the water chart, saturated propane water. And the temperature is 35 degrees. For this temperature, the Cp value of water is 4178. Okay, so we have the values. Now let's find the Q dot. Q dot first from the oil balance. So it will be m dot of oil into Cp of oil in the temperature difference of oil. So this one minus. Now I will do the same equation, but now I will find the delta T of water, and then from delta T of water I can find the outlet temperature of water, or you can write the overall equation as T water outlet will be Q dot by M dot water Cp water plus T water in. Okay, I will write this equation and find the outlet temperature of the water. Okay, let's do it. T water outlet will be equal to Q dot divided by mass flow rate of water into Cp water plus water inlet temperature. Okay. So I have the value, you see it is 40 degrees Celsius and the inlet is 30 degrees Celsius. The averages, you see, we have got a good result. So it means that assumed mean value is okay. So we have finished these two equations. Now comes the last part. We first need to find the LMTD value, okay, and then we will solve for the U value, and then we will find the area of the heat exchanger. So first let's draw temperature versus X. So this one is the temperature and this one is the X. Okay, so for oil starts here. This one is hot inlet and this one is oil outlet, so it means that you will start a high value for temperature of oil and you will drop some low value here. So T oil inlet and the T oil outlet. For the water is the cold part, and for water you start somewhere around here, okay, and the temperature increases, but you should note here that the water outlet temperature is less than oil outlet temperature, so it means that you should limit water outlet temperature here. It should not be more than that one. So it means that I will start somewhere around here, increases, and stop somewhere around here. Because it cannot be more than that one for this problem. But for generally, it can be more. Okay? So this one is the T water inlet, and this one is the T water outlet. Okay. For water, this one is the direction, and for oil, this is the direction. Okay? And now we have the chart. Now let's find the LMTD. LMTD value will be the difference here and the difference here and their logarithmic value. So firstly T oil outlet minus T water inlet, this one minus T oil inlet minus T water outlet, and divide by their LM values. T oil inlet outlet divided by T oil inlet minus T water outlet. same equations, but now they are dividing with an ln. So as you will get the LMTD value, let's find it. If I do that, LMTD value will be equal to first data upstairs, oil outlet minus water inlet. It will be oil outlet minus water inlet, and this one minus oil inlet minus water outlet. Okay, this one is the upstairs, and all of them in brackets. And then I should divide this one by the logarithmic values of the same equation. So ln, I'll copy and paste this one here. Erase one bracket here and now divide. If I do that, the LMTD value is 43. Okay. So I have finished this part, LMTD part is finished. F is 1. Now let's find the U value. Okay. And the U value for this problem will be, if you remember from our previous parts, from our previous slides, that we have said that if the thickness of wall is neglected, if you neglect it, it means that inner surface area, okay, can be taken as the average outer surface area. Okay, they can be taken, they are not equal, but so you can see here they are not equal, but we can assume that they are almost equal. So therefore 1 by U becomes 1 by H inlet plus 1 by H outlet. Okay, if you look at our previous videos, you can see this result. Okay. So it means that if I should find the H, because I have some value of the temperature here, I have the some type value of temperature here, I have one resistance, I have another resistance. Okay, therefore I should find the H inner here, I should find H outer here, and I'll get the temperature values. You should remember from our previous videos. Okay, therefore I will first find the inlet inner part heat transfer coefficient, and then this annular part. First the inner part. For the inner part, this is internal forced convection problem, and here you have water that moves in that direction. Okay, and to find the heat transfer coefficient for internal forced convection, should remember the steps. The first step is that we should find the properties of the water at the average temperature. You should find the conductivity, the Cp value, density, etc. But for this problem, let's ignore the first step. Okay. Now let's solve the problem. Okay. So we have this one is our pipe, and inside the pipe we have the water. Okay, and the water m dot is given. So for the first step should be, you should find the Reynolds number to determine it is laminar or turbulent. Okay, this one is internal forced CV. Okay, and the Reynolds number will be rho Vd by mu. Okay, so what we can do here is that the m dot of the fluid is given. Okay, we can simplify the Reynolds number. So how can we simplify is that m dot is rho area into V. Okay, and the area is pi d square by 4 into the velocity. So you have the rho, you have the V, you have the D. So you can write this one as rho V D into pi d by 4. So you can replace this part here as 4 m dot by pi d. Okay, because rho vd is 4 m dot by pi d. So Reynolds number will become 4 m dot divided by pi d mu. Okay, so let's solve the Reynolds number. So I will get the mu value. This one is from the table. Okay, let's get the mu value and find the Reynolds number. So mu water will be equal to, let's go back to our chart and we look for this temperature for the mu value, and this one is 0.72 10 to the negative 3. And the Reynolds number will be equal to 4 into m dot of water divided by pi d mu. Okay, so you will have the pi into the diameter inlet and into the viscosity. And the Reynolds number is 10 to the 4. Okay, so for this Reynolds number, let's make the values general so that. So this Reynolds number means that it is turbulent. Okay, for the turbulent flow, first we should check if it is fully developed or not. We'll make another approximation. Approximation will be that it is fully developed. It is fully developed turbulent. Okay. Fully developed flow and the turbulent. So we will use internal forced convection for the turbulent flow, but here the thing is that the turbulent flow correlations are for fully developed flow, therefore we assume that it is FTF. Okay. Again, we can check it. Okay, we can check it, but since we don't know the L, we cannot check it now. But after finding L, we can check it. After finding L. Because L by D should be greater than 10 if it is fully developed flow. Now let's use the correlations for this case. When the Reynolds number is greater than 2300 and the internal force of convection. And if you remember our slides. So internal force of convection, we'll use Dittes-Bolter relation, which says that Nusselt number is 0.023, Reynolds number to the power of 0.8, Prandtl number is n, and n is 0.4 for heating and 0.43 for cooling. And in our case, for the water, it is heating problem, because water is heated. Then we will use 0.4. Okay. Then the equation will be 0.023, Reynolds number to the power of 0.8. We will have the Nusselt number 0.023, Reynolds number to the power of 0.8, and the Prandtl number 0.4, because it is heating problem. So Reynolds number, we know the Reynolds number, and we can find the Prandtl from table again, and from here you will get the Nusselt number, and from Nusselt number I can find the H value. Okay, so let's find the Prandtl number for the temperature given here. It is 4.83. So Prandtl number is 4.83, and the Nusselt number becomes 0.023 multiplied with Reynolds number to the power of 0.8, Prandtl number to the power of 0.4. Okay. Nusselt number is 90. And if I know the Nusselt number, and I know that Nusselt number is equal to H L by K. So therefore H becomes Nusselt number into K by the L. Characteristic L, and for the internal force of convection at circular pipe, we know that it is diameter inner. Let's solve it. And again, I will need the conductivity value. Conductivity value for the water is here. Let's take that value here. 0.623. So K water is 0.623, and then H inner will be equal to Nusselt number into conductivity divided by inner diameter, and I've got the inner heat transfer coefficient. Now comes the outer heat transfer coefficient. Let's solve for the annular part. Now annular part is the oil part, which is this part. Here we have the oil that moves, so it is something like this one. Cross section is, and here you have the oil. Okay, so the for annular part, again I should find the Reynolds number. Reynolds number will be rho v diameter hydraulic by mu. Will use hydraulic diameter here because this is not a cross section. The cross section is not the circular, and therefore first I should find the hydraulic diameter. That will be 4 into cross section area by wetted perimeter. Okay, and the cross sectional area is pi diameter outer square minus diameter inner square by 4. This one is the cross sectional area for this one, divided by the perimeter wetted. Wetted perimeter here, you have two wet perimeters, that is wetted by water. This one is the one perimeter, and this one is the second perimeter. These two perimeters are wetted by water, so it will be pi in the diameter outer plus diameter inner. Pi d outer plus pi d inner. So you will have the pi's cancel out, 4's cancel out, diameter outer minus diameter inner square. I can write it as diameter outer minus diameter inner, and diameter outer plus diameter inner, and the sum of it, and you will have the terms cancel out, outer diameter minus inner diameter. I have this value, I have rho, I have mu, I can find the velocity. Velocity will be m dot divided by from rho av. If you remember this equation, rho av. So you will have rho into cross-sectional area. Okay, cross-sectional area is the area that I found here. Okay. So m dot into rho ac, I will find the velocity from here. I can find the Reynolds number. Okay. Firstly, let's find the cross-sectional area. Cross-sectional area will be pi into outer diameter squared minus inner diameter squared by 4. This is the cross-sectional area. Okay, so I can find the velocity here, therefore I need the density. Density of oil, let's go to the chart for oil. Properties of liquids and then oil. At 80 degrees Celsius, oil has a density of 852. So velocity will be equal to m dot of oil divided by density into cross-sectional area. This one is the velocity, and I can find the hydraulic diameter, which is the difference between outer diameter minus inner diameter, and the Reynolds number of oil will be equal to the density into the velocity into the hydraulic diameter divided by the viscosity. I don't have the viscosity value. Viscosity of oil, it will be, if you go back to chart, viscosity of oil is, so you have the viscosity here, dynamic viscosity, and the oil is 0.03232. okay, and the Reynolds number for oil will be the density into velocity into hydraulic diameter divided by the viscosity. And this one is the laminar flow. It means that the annular part is laminar. Again, I need the correlations for laminar flow for annular part. I will go to internal forced convection and laminar flow in tubes. Let's look at if you have the correlations here. So for the annular geometry, can see laminar flow in an annulus with one surface isothermal and the other one is the adiabatic. So it means that, go back to our problem here, this one is the annular surface, this part is assumed as isothermal, this surface is assumed as adiabatic. Okay, and here we have, and this one is an assumption, okay? At the end, you will see if it is good assumption or not. The diameter ratios and the inner Nusselt number and the outer Nusselt number. So this one means you can find the inch value here, or you can find H value here. And since we need H value here, and we need H inner. For our problem is, the notation is outer, therefore I will use outer notation, but here for the correlation, this one is the inner part. Okay, we don't need the Nusselt number here, we don't need it, because we are looking for the resistance between this part and that part. We have one resistance here, another resistance here. Okay, we don't need the resistance value here. If you look, you should look for our previous videos for the detailed explanation of the resistance network for heat exchangers. Okay, now let's find the diameter ratios here, the outer inner diameter by outer diameter. So, diameter ratio, it will be inner diameter divided by outer diameter. We have 0.56, we don't have that value here. We have 0.5 and we have 1 value. Therefore, I can make a linear interpolation here. So linear interpolation. Okay, I'm assuming that the values are in a changing in linear manner. So I have a 5.74. This one is Nusselt number, let's say it. Another color here. When it is 5.74, diameter ratio is 0.5. Okay, and when diameter ratio is 1, and you've got the value here, which is 4.86. Okay, and if I assume the value is linear, I should need to find the value which is very close to 0.5, which is 0.55. Okay. To find that value, I will need the linear interpolation. The Nusselt number will be equal to, so the Nusselt number at 0.55 will be equal to initial Nusselt number, which is 5.74, plus the slope, and the slope will be equal to 4.51 minus the initial one for the Nusselt number, divided by the change in values from and multiplied with the distance that I have traveled, which is 0.55 minus 0.5. Okay, this one will give you the Nusselt number at 0.55. Nusselt number at 0.55 will be equal to the initial Nusselt number 5.74 plus the difference in Nusselt numbers minus 5.74 divided by 1 minus 0.5 makes 0.5 multiplied with 0.55 minus 0.5, it makes 0.05. Nusselt number is 5.65. So from this one I can find the H value. H will be Nusselt number in the K by the hydraulic diameter, and for the K value I should go back the chart again, table again. So I will need the properties for the liquids here, table air 13. So if I go back to 80 degrees Celsius, and the conductivity is given as this one, it is 0.1380. K value for oil is 0.1380, and I can find the H value for the outer part, which will be equal to a Nusselt number multiplied with the K value and divided by the hydraulic diameter. This one will be the outer H part, and I can find the U value here, because U was 1 by, there is the U value here, 1 by H inner plus 1 by H outer, so it will be that U value will be equal to 1 by this one plus 1 by, you can see that the H value is dominated by this part, negative 1, and H is 38. If I take the 2 power of negative 1, it is 38. Okay, so I have the value for the U here, so you can find the U into the area, and the FLMTD, I can find the area here. Area will be equal to, so Q dot divided by U into U into LMTD will give me the area of the heat exchanger. From that area, from this area, I can find the required length of the heat exchanger. So the length will be equal to, so I have assumed that the thickness of the wall is neglected, therefore these two areas are equal. These two areas, I mean the area one up here, the one up here. Okay, the thickness of the wall here is neglected. Okay, and then I can write it as pi d inner into the length. Okay, so I can find the length here. It will be area divided by pi into inner diameter. So the length becomes 66 meters. Okay, so now it is time to check our assumptions. We had two great assumptions. One was the FDF. For FDF, I will divide L by the diameter inner. Okay, diameter actually So I've assumed FDF for the inner part, yes, diameter inner, this is the first part. And I will check for the second approximation that I have here. But here the wall is isothermal and here the wall is adiabatic. Okay, first let's check this one, if it is FDF or not. So FDF check. It will be the length divided by the inner diameter. You can see it is much greater than 10, therefore it is okay. Now comes the second part, that if it is isothermal or not, and we have found the water H as 251 and the oil H was 38. This one is 8. Okay, so what it means is that this one is very bad at accepting heat. Okay. Since this one is very bad at accepting heat, but this one is very good at removing. Okay. Since it is very good at removing and since it is very bad at accepting heat, that means that its temperature doesn't change too much. Okay. If its temperature doesn't change too much, that means that surface temperature doesn't change too much too. The surface temperature is almost uniform or constant. Therefore, isothermal approximation is also